Good morning, church. You guys are all sitting so far back, which isn't fair because the older, I'm going to say we get, the harder it is to make out faces. Because I refuse to wear glasses, so just deal with it. It's good to see you here this morning as we gather to worship God in this place. Whether you are with us in person or online, we are glad that you are gathered as we celebrate God today. A few announcements that I would like to draw your attention to, things that are happening in the life of the church. Even though it is summer and we don't have our Sunday school, our normal Sunday school activities happening, our adult Sunday school class is still meeting. They're meeting at 9 o'clock over in Jenks Lounge here in this building. And they're watching the movie The Chosen this summer and watching an episode each week and having a little discussion about it. And anyone is invited and welcome to join. That's 9 o'clock in Jenks Lounge on Sunday mornings. Also, our Tuesday Women's Bible Study is continuing to meet this month as we study women of the Bible. And midweek at Midtown, our adult Bible study is still meeting this month. I forget how many lessons we have left, a few. So anyone is welcome. We are studying Bible stories for grown-ups. So we are looking at some of the classic Bible stories that we learned as children through grown-up lenses. So it's been a really good study and a good conversation. I invite you to come and be a part of that. We're having a potluck dinner at 5:30 and study starts at 6:15, and you're welcome to come and join. No need to sign up, just bring something to share. Also happening in just a week and a day is Vacation Bible School. Our Vacation Bible School starts a week from tomorrow, and we're so excited as we get ready for that. And I invite you, if you have yet to register, if you have children in your household or grandchildren or neighbors or coworkers' children or strangers on the street, invite you to get them registered and sign up. There's registration forms in Calvin Hall. There's also a QR code around that you can register online for. But it will be a great week, and we do have a VBS wish list. If you would like to help make our VBS wishes come true, there's a little board in Calvin Hall that has some items that we're looking for, donations that we're looking for, and would love for you to be a part of that as we have dreamt about Vacation Bible School and is about to come to fruition. We still have some wishes that are outstanding. Next Sunday is, following worship, will be a Matthew 25 meal and a movie, meal and a message, and that will be someone from the JACL, which I forget, Japanese American something. Sorry. You'll hear more about it next week for sure, but the movie that we're going to be watching is about John Kawamoto's reflections on internment camp. So before he passed away, he made a recording of his reflections for his family, and they are graciously going to share that with us. And so there will be a woman from the JACL, which is Japanese American something or other, that works with the internment camp and memories and all of that, as well as the video, and then as well as some members of the Kawamoto family will be here to do a Q&A as well. So that is a lunch, and we invite you to sign up for that. There's a sign-up sheet in Calvin Hall so that we know how much food to prepare, and it should be a good and informative afternoon, so invite you to be a part of that. Also coming up in 2 weeks is June 18th, which is Father's Day, which is our youth car wash. So it's a great opportunity to get your dirty car washed. You can drop your keys off before worship and then go to the church picnic which will be out on the lawn if the weather cooperates, and have lunch, and then your car will be done and sparkly clean for Father's Day. So invite you to come and be a part of that. There is a sign up for the All Church Picnic, and this year, since it's Father's Day, our hostess for our picnic wants everyone to bring a picture of your dad for a board, to a guessing game of whose dad is that. Invite you. There's more information on that in the bulletin, in the newsletter, and then if you have questions, you can see Pat Gates. There's also a sign up in Calvin Hall for that. One final announcement is this summer, our Sultan of Sales, Ann Henningsen, has offered to host some garage sales, not host, help you host a garage sale at your home. Last weekend, Ann hosted a garage sale at her home, and we raised over $1,000 for the mission and ministry of the church. And her hope is to have two or three more this summer. So if you have a lot of stuff and you just are tired of it, give Ann a call. She will help you host a garage sale, and all the proceeds will then go to the mission and ministry of the church. And so again, Ann is right in the middle, right there. So just in case you didn't know who Ann was, she is the garage sale guru, and invite you to talk to her. One last point of information is this: today, following worship, we will have a congregational meeting to talk about the dissolution of pastoral terms of call for Pastor John. And so I invite you, if you are a member, to stay for that meeting as we do the business of the church. So, friends, it is good to be here, to be together on this beautiful, sunshiny, blue sky day. Invite you to sign yourself in the red hook so that we know that you were here. If you're watching online, check in the chat, say hello. Stand, greet your neighbors as together we worship God. Oh.
Morning. Okay. Yeah. Sorry I missed the lunch the other day. Well, I went to the wrong restaurant.
You're fine.
Okay.
As you make your way back to your seats, I invite you to have a seat. As we have a moment for mission this morning for our monthly mission focus of Habitat for Humanity, so I'm going to invite Greg Caddy up to share with us.
Good
Well, good morning. I'm Greg Caddy, and I serve on the Mission Ministries team. And Habitat for Humanity is one of the mission giving programs that we have supported in the past through financial giving and build teams. This month, we ask you to support this housing-focused nonprofit with your mission giving dollars. Also, please consider joining our Faith House Build scheduled for July 8th from 8 to 3 o'clock. And we are needing at least 10 people to show up to build, or 5 volunteer and or at least 10 people to show up to build and 5 volunteers to help prepare the meal for the build team. So why do we focus on Habitat? Well, the need for affordable housing in our community, not only here, but also in Council Bluffs across the river, has never been more urgent. Housing is considered affordable when a household with low or moderate income can spend less than 30% of their income on rent or mortgage payments. Beyond that 30% level, households are still considered housing cost burdened. Such a burden forces individuals and families to make difficult choices. Many are forced to choose between paying rent, putting food on the table, or keeping utilities turned on. Nearly 30% of all area households are priced out of an affordable living situation. The shortage of affordable housing units in the greater Omaha area is critical. In 2020, a collaborative of 9 local organizations released an assessment of the housing situation in the Omaha Council Bluffs area, which showed our communities are short nearly 80,000 affordable housing units. Without significant intervention, that gap will only continue to increase. Habitat for Humanity works to address this gap by building homes for the purpose of home ownership. Habitat approaches owning a home as an educational process. The new homeowners must complete up to 275 hours of sweat equity working on their build site. Additionally, Habitat provides one-on-one coaching, home buyer education classes, as well as post-purchase support. Several other programs that they provide are home repair loans, weatherization services, veteran home repairs, and as well as neighborhood revitalization programs, which encourage and assist in block by block, community development through renovations, critical home repairs, beautification programs, and demolition of blighted structures. Habitat provides valuable and much needed support in our communities. Please give generously this month to Habitat for Humanity and or see me for more details about joining the July 8th FPC Faith House Build Team or providing lunch for the build team. Thank you. And again, what date is the build? July 8th, that's right. Thank you.
Thanks, Greg. And once again, that is our mission focus for this month. The month of June is Habitat for Humanity. So I'm hoping for sweat equity for this month. Well, it'll be next month, but this month, generating sweat equity. So friends, it is good to be here, and I invite you to stand as we worship.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. The Lord confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
In that opening song, we recognize God's call to us to come to worship Him in all aspects of life, in our joys and our sorrows, in our celebrations and our sadnesses. So let us call ourselves to worship, recognizing God's call. We gather today as people searching for the truth, but finding ourselves always in doubt. Jesus calls us to lead others to Him. A path that ultimately leads also to God and the Holy Spirit. We were never meant to be alone, to keep our faith to ourselves, or to ever doubt that in one form or another, God is always with us. Let us worship God.
He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks.
very thing that we give thanks for is what brings us to the next part of worship, the opportunity to confess to the Lord those times where we have missed the mark, when we have spoken when we shouldn't have or not spoken when we should have, when we have acted when we shouldn't have or failed to act when we should have. All those times in this last week that every one of us has missed something to do, we can confess and we can give thanks knowing that we are forgiven of all that we confess. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we want to believe your promises, but we are unable to conceive of your power. You give us direction and expectations, and we wander and disappoint. We seek to be in your presence, but our doubts and fear cause us to wonder if you are really with us. Continue to show us your authority over the heavens and the earth. Show us your way, even when we can't or won't see you leading us. Be with us when we know you are there and when we feel utterly alone. Hear our silent prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Amen. And my friends, there is good news. We are a needful people, sinful people, lonely people. God created us, gave us Jesus to save us, and the Holy Spirit to call us back to the love and forgiveness that God gives in spite of what we do or fail to do. Thanks be to God. Seated. I'd like to invite any children to come forward and join me for the children's moment up here. How are you all doing today? Good. So, today is a special day on the church calendar. That's not one we talk about a lot. So does anybody remember what last Sunday was? You were all red. Pentecost, that's right. And we celebrate the Holy Spirit. And then if I was to say there was a special day in December, what would that day be about? Maybe a religious holiday? Yeah. Christmas, and we celebrate Jesus Christ, that's right. And we also celebrate him in Easter, right? Usually in April. That, yes, because he is risen. That is awesome. That's what your coloring sheet says? That's good. Today is a day that we celebrate something called the Trinity. Today is Trinity Sunday. And Trinity, boy, that's a big word, isn't it? Anybody know what Trinity means? Yeah? That's right. It's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And if you break apart the word Trinity, like if we talked about a tricycle, what's a tricycle? Why is it called a tricycle? Because it's got three wheels. So tri is three. That's the first part of Trinity. The second part of Trinity is the word unity. What does unity mean? Together, that's right. Now, the church in general, for centuries, has had a very difficult time explaining the Trinity. And part of it's because it's a mystery. We don't fully understand it. We can't fully understand it. So there have been different ways to think about the Trinity, because the idea of the Trinity is you have Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three distinct aspects that are all one. So sometimes the idea of a shamrock has been used. Okay, so a shamrock has three distinct leaves, but they're all shamrock. Or sometimes we've talked about an egg, right? Because an egg has three parts, the outer shell, the egg white, and the egg yolk. They're all an egg. It really doesn't exist without the other parts, right? Sometimes we've used the idea of ice, of ice, because it's in the form, if it's water, in the form of ice, gas, or vapor, or water, liquid. So three different parts, and I kind of mixed that part up, so I just confused it up even more for y'all. But I want to try another way of thinking of Trinity, okay? I need three volunteers who are comfortable with moving around or being seen. Jacob, that's one, two, and three. Why don't you guys join me here, up here? And what I want you to do is stand together and link arms so you're in a line, okay? So just stand next to each other and link arms. So, okay, now go ahead and link arms here. Keep your arms linked, okay? Now, I need a volunteer somewhere near the front over here that's willing to stand up. Paul, are you willing to, oops, who'd you call out? Okay, will you all, as a group, linked together, go give Paul a hug? All right, you can come back. Thank you, Paul. Thank you for voluntolding. So now my question, which one of you gave Paul a hug? You did? Did you? Did you? You patted him on the back? Did you too? So which one of you did it? Or did you, all did it, right? Right? Uncomfortable big hug. There you go. All right, and you guys can be seated now too. So the idea of the Trinity is you have God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. And even though it may be one of them doing something different, like maybe patting them on the back, they all do something together when they go out and minister to the world. So in a way, in a non-religious way, you three were a Trinity. You were one body with one action, giving Paul a hug, right? That's kind of a way to think about God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Because even though Jesus Christ was here on earth and was on a cross, God and the Holy Spirit were there as well. Even though God created the earth at the very beginning, the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ were there. They never act alone. They're always together. And that's the idea of the Trinity, which should give us some hope, because now what we celebrated at Pentecost is the Holy Spirit came. And when the Holy Spirit came, that also means God and Jesus Christ are still with us as well. That's a very special thing to remember. So my challenge to you for the next week is to find two other people you can link up with and do good for the world together, okay? All right, let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful for your presence with us, your presence in the form of the Holy Spirit, your presence in the form of Jesus Christ so many years ago here on this earth, and your presence as the Almighty Creator. And we are so grateful that together you are with us in all things. Bless us until we gather again. We pray this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. You guys can go ahead and be seated. Thank you.
Lord, I wait. Hold me ever close. with such a love I can't escape. For your nearness, Lord, I'm hoping. For your nearness, Lord, I long. I have no need of any other. I have found where I belong. Yes, I have found where I belong. So draw me nearer, Lord. Never let me go. Closer to your heart. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer, Lord. In your nearness there is healing. What was broken now made whole. Restoration in its fullness. Lasting hope for all who come. In your nearness there is shelter. Where you are is where I'm home. I have need of only one thing, to be here before your throne. To be here before your throne. Draw me nearer, Lord. Never let me go. Closer to your heart. Draw me nearer, Lord. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer, Lord. Draw me nearer and keep me here. Keep me here. There's nowhere else I'd rather be. And keep me here. Keep me here. There's nowhere. Never let me go. Closer to your heart. Draw me nearer, Lord. Draw me nearer, Lord. Draw me nearer, my Lord. Thank you.
a familiar tune, familiar words that we sing. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. So as John said in his children's message this morning, the church calendar today is Trinity Sunday. It is a day dedicated to understanding the doctrine of the Trinity. So are you ready? It's a short lecture I've prepared for this morning. No, don't worry. I'm not going to try to explain the doctrine of the Trinity because it is such a mystery that the great theologians of the past and present haven't been able to come close to comprehending it. But I will share with you a bit about what it is and why it is important. So the Trinity is the three persons of the Godhead. The Father is God for us. The Son is God with us. And the Spirit is God in us. The power of three is what we need to hold on to understand that God in three persons is for us, with us, and in us. And apart from the Godhead, we find ourselves lost and alone. There are many examples that have been used over the years to try to help understand the Trinity. John spoke of a few of them. I'm going to refresh your memory a little bit. But each of these examples really falls short of capturing the mystery of the Trinity. The first is water. Water comes in three forms, right? Liquid, solid, and gas. Ice, water, and vapor. So like the Trinity, kind of three forms, right? Father, Son, and Spirit, of the same substance, God. But where this analogy falls apart is each of those elements of water cannot exist at the same time. You can't have liquid and frozen and gas all in the same space at the same time. Each form of water cannot do that. Water appears in different forms and modes, but never does so while at the same time maintaining its essential waterness. This disregards the personhood of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, God in three persons, because those three persons are equal and they can be present at the same time. The next illustration is that of a clover, three-leaf clover, three leaves of the same plant, all parts that are connected to make one plant, right? Again, like the Trinity, three parts, but it falls apart after that because the leaves of a clover cannot exist without the other. And it can't be separated. It is a part of a whole. So this analogy suggests that the persons of the Godhead are three parts of God, that with each part making up one-third of the Trinity. But that's not so, right? Because God is fully God, Father, Son, and Spirit. Each person is not 33 1/3% part of God. Each is 100% God. And the last one is that of an egg. One egg, three different parts. A shell, a white, a yolk. One God, three different persons. Father, Son, Spirit. Again, this analogy falls apart as each element of an egg cannot stand alone. An egg suggests that the members of the Trinity are just different parts of God. The parts of an egg are not equal, and they do not share the same nature. The shell is a different material from the white and the yolk. It is not 100% of the egg, and the parts are not equal. While the Trinity, again, is three equal and distinct persons, each 100% God. So all of the analogies that we can think of to help understand the Trinity are helpful to a point, and they fall short because there is truly nothing that can describe the power and the mystery of the Trinity. We simply have to lean into that mystery. The simple version of the doctrine of the Trinity tells us that there's one God who is three distinct persons, existing as a community of self-giving and loving relationships with each other. So there's one God. We know this. Unlike other religions practiced in biblical history, the people of the Old Testament and the New Testament were monotheists, believing in the one true God. Deuteronomy 6:4 says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul says the same thing. He says, "There is no God but one. One God and Father of all." So one God, three distinct persons. Now this is where it can get a little harder to understand. But I encourage you to stay in it, to lean into the mystery, and don't try and figure it all out. But I'm going to tell you some things. The Bible reveals to us that God is Father. Ephesians 4:6 says, "One God and Father of all, who above all and through all and in all." We know that God is Son. 1 John 5:20 says, "And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life." And we know that God is Holy Spirit. Acts 4:31, when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together shook, and all were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. It is very apparent as we read scripture that the three persons of the Trinity are distinct from each other. They each have a role to play, but they are also linked together. Matthew 28:19 says, "In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." And those are the words that we use when we baptize, that we baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And the benediction that Paul writes in 2 Corinthians says, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Reminding us again that each person in the Trinity has a distinct function. Not only that, but all throughout Scripture, we also see how each person of the Trinity relates and interacts with each other. The Father sent his Son into the world, John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son." The Son, Jesus, often talked about his Father. "Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing on his own, but can only see what the Father's doing. For whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise." And the Son also prayed to the Father. In Matthew 11, he says, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent." The Holy Spirit, we know, descended upon Jesus as a dove at his baptism. And later, Jesus promised to send the Spirit to his disciples. When the Advocate comes, he says, "Whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf." Each person, 100% God, and shares the same divine nature. So hopefully by now your heads aren't spinning and your eyes aren't glazing over and you're sticking with me and not making that list of things that you need to do this afternoon. But I encourage you to hold on a little longer, to lean into the mystery and be in awe of God, who is both totally beyond us and yet entirely close to us. Because, friends, this is why the Trinity is important. It is not our total comprehension of it, but our acknowledgement and belief in the power of three, the Godhead, the three in one. God the Father, God the Creator, spoken of as the one who directs and governs all that he has made. He is the one who sits upon the throne in heaven. He and the Son are equal, but Jesus prays to the Father. He and the Spirit are equal, but the Spirit is sent by the Father. The Father is God for us. And the Son, he was not made by the Father. There was never a time in which the Father existed and the Son did not. When the time was right, the Father sent his Son to come to earth to be born of flesh and blood. In a human body, Jesus is fully God and fully man. He did not lose part of his deity when he became a man, but only added humanity. Jesus lived in the way that humans should live. Jesus loved God the way that we should love God. He obeyed God the way that we should obey God. But his obedience resulted in something that we will never have to do. He let himself be crucified on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. He was killed, but God the Father raised him from the dead on the third day. He is the great Redeemer, the great Intercessor, the great King, the great Savior of his people, and he lives to this day, waiting until the time is right once again when he returns. The Son is God with us. God, the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is God in us. The Spirit is the one who handles the human soul, the one who causes us to spiritually be born again, the one who lives inside us from the day we ask Jesus into our heart, the one who enlightens our heart, opens our eyes, and motivates our hands and feet. The Spirit is no less God than the Father or the Son, nor is the Spirit less a person, though we never quite know how to address the Spirit. The Spirit is not a force, not an angel. The Spirit is not another way to say something about God that God did. The Spirit is finite, eternal God, the third member of the Trinity. One author wrote, "When we have the Spirit of God bearing witness in our spirit, in our bodies, our lives can be fully renewed and constantly restored. As such, we carry the very breath of God in us, and our spirituality finds its fullness in all bodies, the earth and all living things. Fully connected to God, the earth, birds, fish, meadows, our neighbors and ourselves, we all become children of God, beloved by God, beloved by Abba. Entangled in this vast notion of grace, we find the breath of God in our communities by the way of seeing the Trinity in an ever-encompassing event of connections, connectivity, mutualities, and entanglements. It is all three persons, the Blessed Trinity, that are essential in our faith and how we relate to and how we understand God. Equal, powerful, and inseparable. When we live in awe of the Trinity, we also live with the Trinity. It is the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, that allows us to be a family of hope and promise, a family of world changers and love bringers. As we live by the Spirit, we live together with Christ, covered by the love of God. Together, we suffer. Together, we have no fear. Together, we cry out and move the world. Together, we love without condition. The power of three is what we need to hold to understand that God in three persons is for us, with us, and in us. And apart from the Godhead, we are nothing but lost and alone. Our scripture for today are Jesus' final words to his disciples, and they fill us with hope and encouragement for what is to come. Matthew 28, 16 through 20, and I invite you to hear God's word for you today. Now, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, Jesus, they worshiped him, but they doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Friends, this is God's word for us today. Thanks be to God. The Father is God for us. Christ is God with us. The Spirit is God in us. Amen and amen.
Please stand. I will come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fear. You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here. I am hope for all who are hopeless. I am eyes for all who long to see. Shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow.
We'll stop there. I invite you to have a seat.
I have a few prayer concerns to share with you this morning. We lift up the family of Carolyn Adams in prayer. She passed away on the 21st of May, and her funeral was last week. So we pray for the family and friends and co-workers of Carolyn. We ask for special prayers for Alex as he grieves the loss of his sister who passed away yesterday. So please hold Alex in your prayers. And also we pray for Amelia Boswell as she had knee surgery this week and is recovering. You'll see her moving around on crutches this morning. But Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we gather as your people in all aspects of our lives, in celebrations and sorrows, in new births and in deaths. We know you are the God of all good things. We lift up in prayer Alex as he grieves the loss of his sister. Surround him with your healing light that he may know of your love. May he feel the support and care of those who love him as he walks through this difficult journey of grief. We pray for the family of Carolyn as they have celebrated her life this week and celebrated her entry to eternal life. She knows the joy of the resurrection, and we pray that family and friends will come to know that joy as well. And Lord, we lift up Amelia and all those who have had surgery recently, that their bodies may be strengthened, their bones knit together. We thank you for the doctors and nurses who watched over them and who brought their medical knowledge that you've given to our people to bring about healthy and healing bodies. Bring them back to full health quickly, Lord. We just ask you to give them patience as they seek to get back to their regular activities and give them strength to grow stronger to serve you. Lord, we pray all of these things in your name, as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Whenever we worship, we are called to bring our offerings to the Lord in celebration of what he has done in our lives. We invite the ushers to come forward that we may give our gifts to the Lord. And if you're with us at home, there are a variety of ways you can give that are on your screen as well.
Thank you.
Bring these offerings in joyful celebration of what you have done in our lives and what you're doing in the world. May these offerings be multiplied for your good use, that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord. Amen.
That following worship, after the postlude and a little bit of settling, we will have a congregational meeting where members are invited to vote. Visitors, we're glad that you're here. You're welcome to stay, but there's cookies and coffee in the other room. But friends, today is Trinity Sunday. And as you go, know that God is for us, God is with us, and God is in us. And as we go, we do not go alone, but that God goes always before us, behind us, beside us, all around us, holding us tightly in the palm of his hands. And may you go in peace. Amen.